My name is Shyam Gupta. Date of birth is March 28, 1922. I was born in the town of Nabha in the state of Punjab, India. I came here as a student. That is the only way you could come to the United States, earn a degree, and prove yourself that you are worthy of being here. I came in 1956, December. I had applied before I came here to maybe 30, 40 universities. I had a couple of friends that I was traveling with, and we decided to go to Harvard University, Washington. That's where I went first time. I came to America. That was a great, difficult thing. Didn't have any money, or the money I had, I was not able to draft against that. So I went to a very poor friend of mine, which I asked him for 5,000 rupees. My father was chief engineer, but he had died a few years back, and our family was an elite family in Nabha, and my friend could not believe that I went to him for mere 5,000 rupees. But anyway, so I borrowed the money, and at that time the Reserve Bank of India will not give you more than $500 of foreign exchange. So I put that $5,000 in the bank, got the exchange, and out of that we had to spend the money to travel from India to America too. So we came to London by plane. I think it was Pakistan International Airways, PIA fame. So in London, we didn't have a flight. We went to a Cook's Travel. They gave us a seat on SS Ivernia. That was a steamship, a beautiful ship. I came to Auburn in 1957. And we already had a friend over there. So he was instrumental in getting his admission over there. So we left the Harvard University in good standing and came over here, Auburn, and started schooling. I earned my degree in 1958, June, civil engineering. When I came here, even though I had a good background in engineering, I didn't think I would get a job as an engineer. So I came in my khakis and my work clothes to be able to do anything, dishwashing and whatever it will take for me to continue my stay. But when I first came here, after the first semester at Auburn, then there was summer vacation. And we asked, well, the money was running very short. When I came here first, I had only $528. That's all I had. And out of that, I had to pay fees, pay my boarding, pay my school, and almost be able to live there for 2 years. And it did. Okay. So, of the first semester, since the money was running low, we asked the people around as to where can we go for a job. And everybody said that if you can't find a job in Chicago, you can't find any place else. The very first day, in the evening, I applied for a job, and they called me the next morning. They talked to me about my background and all that. He said, well, take off your coat and hang it over there. I said, what's going on? So, and that's, they told me this is my desk. I didn't know what it was my desk for to apprentice or something like that. You know, what was it? Then they asked me, what kind of salary would you take? Well, in those days, the question was big, that you were afraid to ask for too much that somebody might just out try to reject you out there. So I said, well, at that time the going rate was about $2.50 for the engineers. I said, well, $2.50. The guy came, and after that he said, will you accept $440 a month? That was more than $2.50. So that was one good thing about America that came to notice that they are not looking for just beating you down. They will try to give you what you are really worth. After Auburn, I stayed here for 2 years. We went to India. At that time, Surinder, Jinder, Narinder, and Jugender, they were all public schools. And it was a problem for the kids to come here because they were not proficient in English yet. So we had to make some arrangements. Luckily, in those days, the first public school, which Americans and Indians, Englishmen call private school, that first school opened in our hometown. And well, that was a God-given gift to us. We could put the boys in that school, more or less satisfied that they'll be taken care of. And I and my wife Sheila and Sammy came to United States. Surinder, your father, wrote to me that the things were getting pretty bad in India because there was going to be a conflict with China. And there was a lot of concern that there might be a lot of bloodshed and all that. So I expedited their arrival, their departure from India, and got them in the United States. And they were that was in 1963. Big question at that time was that all these boys, Surinder, Rajinder, Jugender, Narinder, they were about 3 years ahead of their counterparts in America. Surinder had completed his high school at 14, and Rajinder 14, Jugender 15, Narinder 14. So the big question over here, we wanted to have them admitted in the school was, how to, where to put them. Some people advised us that you should put them where they belong academically. Other people said, no, they should be put down along with their age group so that they mature at the same time. But the principal of the school told me that if you put them in with the American kids, the 14-year kids are only in a barely starting high school. So you'll be retarding their efforts and you might be losing a value of challenge in them because all these things will be to them to be already discussed and studied and also. So I took the chance of taking them to the high school and the junior college. So I told them that I test them academically and find out where they fit. So Surinder, even though he came from the 10th grade in the Punjab Public School, Nava, he was able to go to the Thornton Township Junior College in the first year. So on the basis of that, Rajinder went to the most senior year in high school, Jugender after that, Narinder after that. So they were all set. The big question was how to send them to college. At that time in Chicago, they did not have too many junior colleges. And the only college that we had was in downtown in Navy Pier. And at that point, for me to be able to afford them transportation, buy them car, separate apartments and so on, was very almost impossible. So I started looking for a job. The I-10 and I-12 in Louisiana were just getting started. 150 miles up expressways. And they interviewed me. The name of the company was Howard Needles, Tamman and Bergendorf. And then they hired me as their chief drainage engineer for 150 miles of interstate highway. So that's where we came to Baton Rouge. The tuition was very cheap. I think the semester fee was, $91 or $101 a semester. So, I mean, good thing, that's all I could afford, you know. Surinder is our eldest child, and more or less he was a pace setter for the family. And he went to medical school after trying, and he was instrumental in guiding and pacing others to go to the medical school. Rajinder, mostly he went on his own, applied to Duke University, which I didn't even know. He was accepted with a full scholarship. So he was not on any kind of allowance or subsidy from me. He was able to take care of himself over there. Jugendra went to university, was staying at home, and Jugendra was completing his master's in finite analysis and structural engineering. Jugendra is very homely. He's very nervous in a way. He's very, very compassionate, and he didn't want to stay away from the family. Manindra went to dentistry, came to medical school, and then he completed the medical school. He was a little deal maker, here and there, you know. Sesemi stayed with us all around all the time. Some of the things which I didn't know about her in the early childhood, she was very, I think, Sesemi was done a very great service by her going to the counseling at Loyola University. She came out to be a very, very good counselor. And as a matter of fact, until this day, when I'm lost, I go to her. Then we had to start worrying about where they were all going to medical school, and the time had come that they started looking for wives and all that. We have 17 grandchildren, and of course, you are the eldest one. You got the maximum love from everybody because you were the first one. And then, of course, until now, we have about 17 grandchildren and 16 great-grandchildren. It has been a very, very enjoyable, very fruitful life. Everybody was happy. This is one of the unique families in the United States where we have almost in the current family, out of grandchildren and children, we have 17 MDs and 3 attorneys, JDs. And there are still 2 or 3, 4 siblings still going to school. My grandfather had passed away while I was in high school. So that was the most tragic thing that ever happened to me. And my father passed away a year later. My father passed away at the age of 52. Devastating. If there's anything I regret in my life, and that is that I was not able to do anything for my mother and my father. That's it. This load on my mind. I just can't do enough to earn their hard work, sacrifice, patience, everything. In India, the marriages are mostly arranged, and usually the personality of the parents is so dominating that the children do not have the courage to ask them to participate in selection. No, whatever the parents have done, that's good enough. The parents look at the families, your family, they exchange information. Yeah, the family is good, the girl is good looking, okay, they get married. In my case, I was not quite satisfied with that. So I didn't have the courage to go to my mother. But I went to my uncle, Amarji's father. So I said, I have a little problem. I don't want to marry anybody but seeing and talking to her. So he kind of arranged that. So I met my wife at her parents' house in the garden outside. It was not possible that that the girls could be shown around in public. We had to be in a kind of private. So that's how I selected her. It was in 1943. And we were married, we were married 61 years.
Did you ever get your own pocket money when you were a child?
No, that's an interesting question. Didn't get any pocket money. My mother was very generous, and I didn't have the need or courage to ask her. Whenever I did need money, I would go to the room where the safe was, and go over the floor and pick up any money on there, because she was so forgetful. The money was just lying around. I swept the money in my pocket and got. As a matter of fact, I did not break a rupees note until I was in the 10th grade.
Did you have any hobbies or did you play any sports?
I used to be a member of the first 11 hockey team. I played football, which you call soccer here. And I played hockey. And later on in college days, I started tennis. When I went to engineering school, I was a 400 meter runner also. Painting came just as a sidekick, as a hobby. I mean, I was very good in drawing in school. And as a matter of fact, in FC College, when there was a dissection of frog and botany, drawing up trees and so on, that was the first college I went to where there was a co-education. So many girls would come to me for drawing. So I was good in drawing. But the first painting I drew up, a single line diagram, was for Namita. I said, well, let me try that. And it came out all right, and it was kind of applauded and so on. So after that, I started just playing with the brush and found out that I do have some talent for that. And now, as you would see in the exhibition, there are quite a few, there are about 20, 30 paintings that I have done. I think my life has been very satisfactory. God has given me more than I deserved or I wanted. Everything that I wanted, he has given me more. So I'm thankful to the Almighty for all the everything that all the children are so well placed. They don't need any help from anybody. They're straightforward and proud enough not to ask for anything, and that's a great feeling. I and my wife have been blessed with the grandchildren who are so adoring and so devoted. It's wonderful to have children like that, and our great grandchildren are bundles of joy, and their smile and so on and so forth. So I'm thankful to God for everything that has happened to the family. I couldn't have asked for more. Of course, you can always ask for more.